Welcome to the CBER Lunchbox Podcast. I'm Silvia Ceaușu. I'm a postdoc at University College London doing research in biodiversity conservation. Welcome to the CBER Lunchbox Podcast. Today I'm chatting with Susanne Marieke Vogel, who is a postdoc at Aarhus University in Denmark. Before that, she obtained her bachelor degree and master degree at Wageningen University in the Netherlands, and her PhD degree from University of Oxford. We'll talk about her path to research, ethics in conservation, and her current work on human-wildlife interactions. Welcome.
Thank you. Well, thank you for having me.
We'll start with a few quick-fire questions just to unlock our spontaneity. So what is your favorite species?
Oh, that's, for me, it's a difficult question. Okay. I would say from all species, either barn owl, domestic cat, or elephant.
This is surprising. I was almost sure you're going to say elephants.
Like so, most people. That's why it's really difficult. But I'm fascinated by barn owls. And I really like cats. So, which is also a bit contradictory to like birds and cats.
So what's your favorite fieldwork location?
Maybe the most life-changing experience I had, or the most amazed I was by the field site, was in Uganda. So I was working in northern Uganda. I feel like that made a big impact on me. But also, I feel like every field work, even in the Netherlands or any place, is special to me. And I it's really hard for me to choose, because I think all different sites bring you something new, right?
Why did you like Uganda so much?
So that was where I did my master project. I think, first of all, that I managed to get there and to convince my supervisor to let me go there and do the project I wanted to do. That was very special to me. And then I met lots of amazing people. And I feel like learning about the way people were living there really changed how I thought about the world and how I thought about science and conservation. And yeah, I feel like...
Very tempted to ask you, what was your master project?
So I studied forest and nature conservation. So actually, before I did that, I started with anthropology. And okay, maybe I should even zoom a little bit back and go to high school, where I had to figure out what I wanted to study. I decided I wanted to learn about elephant overpopulations, as I called it at the time. But maybe what I wanted to know was, how can we combine caring about a species and wanting a species to thrive in an area, and also obviously people living there and people also dealing with the situation. And I got fascinated by the parks in South Africa, where there was this high amount of elephants and people trying to figure out ways to deal with these high populations. And so I decided this human development, economic, or anything that humans want from nature, and then, or from landscapes, and then combine that with nature conservation of endangered or vulnerable species. So that's why I decided I wanted to study anthropology to understand it from the human side. So I think I figured out, okay, if I want to work on how people can live with wildlife, then I need to understand people, right? So, after a year, I realized I want to, even in my studies, combine both perspectives from the animal side and the human side. And at the university where I was studying, it didn't really seem feasible. So I swapped a university to Wageningen University. And then I also swapped my emphasis. So I studied mainly forest and nature conservation with minors in, they called it sustainable development or resource use. And so basically the whole time, I wanted to combine those things, and I figured out during my bachelor's that it was crop consumption or crop rating, whatever you want to call it, that most inspired me to do research or to do my project. So I was looking for species, and at the same time, I was also at the time volunteering for Jane Goodall Institute in the Netherlands, basically raising funds for chimpanzee conservation. And through them, I heard about this project in Uganda where they had lots of issues with chimpanzee attacking people, so, and eating crops. And I felt like it was a special moment where my interest and this volunteer work I was doing sort of on the side all the time were connecting. So I got in touch with the organization there, and I asked, okay, I'm willing to project to do a project and study things or get data that you need for your NGO. And that's a bit how it happened. Of course, there was lots of effort there and from both them and trying to get this. Basically, I showed up with, I feel like when I think back at myself at that time, I was not really prepared. And mm-hmm. I wasn't really sure. Of course, I learned a lot about science, but I just walked into it very open, like oblivious and open-minded. But yeah, just basically only when I arrived, we started to figure out all the logistics, and I was randomly getting rights to the places and the field site and where I was going to stay. It was all very much undecided. And it's such a contrast to doing fieldwork now as a postdoc, where I have all these people helping me figure out things beforehand, and like everything has to be smooth. And at the time it was, yeah, it was more like rock up and try and figure out how life goes over there. So of course, because I always was interested in combining with development studies, and I had this anthropology focus, I was very aware of, or I was to some point aware to, of course, there's people having issues with conservation and NGOs and being kicked out of parks and all that, basically the negative side that's often forgotten when we think about, oh, saving the world or saving species. I knew, or I was trained or studying that, but in a way, coming to a place and having this mindset of, okay, I can learn about how these people deal with these animals. So I was testing out an epidemiological model on which crop types they had mainly had issues with, chimpanzee and baboon. So I came there to learn, right? That was my motivation. But at the same time, I wish I would have known more about how to be interacting with an NGO that also has a very nature conservation attitude, right? And an image. And then I think at the moment, I'm very much questioning my role in conservation science when I go to other countries. And am I even allowed to do this for, like, in general, like ethically, but also for myself? Do I even agree with me going somewhere? And I feel like, yeah, I wish I thought more about that, or I was taught more about that.
Yeah, I think this kind of thoughts are actually relatively recent in conservation in regarding, you know, the ethical aspects of us conducting research there. And
But I feel like when I was there, of course, you have these thoughts. And mm-hmm. it's like also during my PhD, I had these thoughts, and I was mm-hmm. constantly very confused about having sort of a gut feeling what is right and what is wrong, and then seeing things or being confronted with people that you should admire because they're more senior to you and they are from the organizations you are, or the research groups you are inspiring to become part of. So they are doing things or saying things that maybe feel wrong. And then how do you, as a junior who has no knowledge, who's completely dependent on these other people to live out your dream, and how do you deal with this when there's not a conversation? And how do you deal with it when you're worried to be judged by them and you want to be an insider? But also you realized, oh, maybe I am an outsider. I don't know, you constantly you're playing with being outsider, insider, and I feel like trying to create a safe space where you can talk about this and have reflexivity, or right. trying to together figure out in a dialogue how to deal with these questions. I feel like that's something that's indeed very new, but I feel like the feelings were always there.
So could you maybe give some examples of the situations that require more self-reflexivity from a researcher?
Yes, of course. So, for example, I think colonialism is not just in the roots of modern day conservation. You're still confronted with it on a day-to-day basis, especially when you're doing fieldwork with maybe situations of racism or neo-colonialism. And I think it's not just always even in a way that people can claim it's accidental, or they were just not aware of something, like who gets to be on a paper or who gets excluded from certain decisions, or who ate with whom in the research camp. But I think sometimes it's also very explicit. Like, I know of stories that me or my friends experienced where someone was told not to be friends with their field collaborator, and they were comparing the field collaborator to dogs, and that they need to be trained like dogs. Or I've heard of people who heard someone complain that they refused to shower in the same shower as the staff of the research camp where they were doing research, because they would get diseases from the people. And it's also not just in fieldwork, right? So a few years ago, I saw someone receive an award for their conservation efforts. And at the acceptance speech, the person mentioned that a group of people were the future of conservation in Africa. And then behind the presenting person, a map of the African country appeared with photos of only white men. So I think we all have a job to inform ourselves, right? And to, if we want to be part of this conservation world, to try and learn from maybe the past and do a better job.
So what was your PhD thesis about? And what are you working on now?
My PhD thesis, I think I called it something like how decisions lead to conflict, which already the word conflict was very controversial. So I almost changed it. But basically, I wanted to look at the decisions that animals make. So in my case, it was elephants foraging crops. And I was mainly looking at movement decisions and foraging decisions and the role agricultural fields and crops played in that. And from the human side, I was looking at why farmers chose to adopt or not adopt mitigation methods that were offered. So I think what I saw at least a lot was NGOs or government bodies giving mitigation methods. So any strategy to try and reduce elephants coming into fields and eating crops. I was wondering why, if we do these projects and we claim in these papers, oh, this is the solution to elephants eating crops, why isn't everyone then doing it? I feel like that's what triggered the idea behind it, and basically allowing the floor to the farmers themselves to say what they wanted. And I think that's why we used ethnographic decision models. So that the ethnographic part was mainly them explaining in their own words. So we're trying to see the methods that they were offered. Were they actually the methods they were asking for? Because people didn't really ask them what they were asking for, right? That was mainly the idea behind my PhD. So I think that idea that I was trying to think about human elephant coexistence and maybe also how decisions play a role in it, it's kind of linked to what I did in my postdoc. So I did one postdoc, I finished, and now I'm doing my second. And in my first, I was mainly looking at what makes an area suitable for elephants and rhino this time as well, but then also trying to integrate this human dimension with the ecological dimension. And for my current postdoc, I'm looking again at human wildlife coexistence, so a bit broader. But in the Masai Mara, so I'm focusing on one case study or field site. And so maybe the main theme of my postdocs is trying to understand how not just ecological factors determine where an elephant or a rhino or whatever species should be, but that it matters a lot what the people want that live there. So basically, we're almost literally asking people, do you want to live with elephants? Do you want to live with rhino? And do you want to live with conservation? And I feel like the answer to that, if it is no, then that should be accepted. Or if conservation organizations don't want that to be the answer, then they have to work and they have to make sure people actually want to live with the species. And I like how it's sort of turning around the idea that the humans are bad, because so the site I work at the moment in my postdoc, it is the Masai Mara in Kenya. And I don't know if you read, but a few years ago, there was all these papers about, oh, humans are the threat, or the Maasai are a threat to the wildebeest migration routes or to the parks. Mm-hmm. And I feel like it's such a strange narrative that the humans that are being put up with this wildlife, and in a way, of course, they benefit sometimes from tourism, but still we in the quotation marks, force them to live with these animals. And if they don't want to, why would that be okay? So I think I'm really into political ecology and trying to break apart these narratives for myself, also about myself. And I think I find it fascinating to try and see, okay, there's this narrative, where is it coming from? How can we try and look at it from a different angle? And and right now, my main idea in it is trying to see, okay, how can we merge? How can we make sure that the social side or the human side is also incorporated in the ecology, and how can we allow the opinion of where should these animals be, not to be only from scientists, but also from the people actually going to or are living with the species.
I mean, there's this argument that biodiversity is important also for human benefits, and often these benefits are long-term and on large scale. So, you know, it supports the resilience of ecosystems and stuff like that. And despite this this cost that farmers or people who live with this species, despite this cost, there is a benefit of preserving biodiversity, you know, for long-term well-being. How do you see this? Is there a way to balance this? Because even if it's difficult at the moment to live with the species, it might be favorable to have the species preserved for their future benefits.
But then who is the one deciding this? And who is the one observing this? Because it almost implies that us as scientists, and maybe us Western scientists, we can take this step back and we can look into the future. And we have this more knowledge. And I feel like what we should actually be thinking, these people, or these quotation marks again, or the people that are currently living with this wildlife, they have done that for many generations, most likely. And if anyone knows about the benefits of living with them, it's also them. And I feel like in my research, one of the things I like to do is play this sort of game that's called Living with Elephants. And it's all about trying to give the floor, not just for the issues, but also for the benefits. And there's many benefits people see that I can't even think about, right? Mm-hmm. And I feel like, I think all people are rational. All people use different, multiple things that they take with them in their decision-making. It's not like we are the ones that have long-term are the only ones with a long-term perspective and trying to look holistically or integrated. I think the people that are actually living with the animals are much more complex in their decision making and their future perspective than we are having. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And I think we can't assume that we know more or that we know better and that we are the only ones seeing the benefits of biodiversity, right? Because we are not even always the ones living. Like, we can live a very isolated life over here. Quotation marks here in Denmark. I can choose to live in my house, have no interaction with biodiversity, right? And I can imagine that's a happy life. But if you live in the Masai Mara, it's more unlikely that you can live a happy life without ever thinking about biodiversity.
Tell me how you got into science. Have you always thought of becoming a scientist?
I feel like I never really thought about becoming a scientist. All the people, so basically all my friends, my close friends from primary school, I didn't go to the same level with them. So then all my new friends from school, they all went to university. I was just going to university, and it was just a question of which topic. Yeah, and then after university, so I was the first one from my family to go to university. So it was all new to me, but also my parents were learning about the whole system. And yeah, I think we sort of did it together. So I was super lucky to have lots of support from home. And then in university, I think, I don't know, I didn't think where it was going to lead to. I was just hoping I would work for some cool organization after. And then I think I was at the end of my bachelor when I was at a meeting with one of my favorite teachers who I really admired. And he said, so I was in the board, the study association board with him. And he said something like that he was amazed or a bit disappointed that so many people are in the study program from the study for nature conservation were not even considering going into science after. And I feel like that was the first moment I was like, oh, you can go into science? And it was so silly because I was at the university, right? But it just felt like such a different world. And then even at the end of my master's, I was chatting with a friend and I remember her saying, oh, you should really do a PhD. And I was thinking, me? No. I never really thought about it until she said that. And then I don't know, I just never saw myself as a scientist or even think I could be it. Or yeah, I think I had to deconstruct that what I thought a scientist was. And I think it was male But that was also silly because there were also females teaching me. But most, right. The majority of the professors and the senior, they were male, and maybe from a certain, maybe in my head, even my field was not science. Maybe mm-hmm. it was more basically, what's his name in the Big Bang Theory, Sheldon Cooper, or right. what is his name? Like, or maybe Ross from Friends. I feel like whatever you see portrayed as scientist or called labeled scientist, right? Because I don't even think that my professors necessarily would label themselves a scientist, but obviously they were. But I think, yeah. And in a way, I feel, and I still feel, maybe it's just me, but I feel that scientists are maybe considered to be like an identity. Sorry, that science is your identity. I think maybe that science, being a scientist, is considered to be an identity, and it's one-dimensional, and it is atheist, and it is very objective, and in a way, it defines your whole being. I think that's what I think a scientist is. And actually, I hope it's not, and maybe it's just my idea or my perception of what.
So you feel that to become a scientist, you kind of have to adopt this whole list of personal attributes?
I feel instead of adopting things, I feel like it's shedding things. I feel like I want to be a scientist that is considered to be complex and to consider to be multidimensional. And I have many layers, and I want it to be okay to be a scientist and to be respected as a critical thinker and believe in God and have faith that, as I do. And I want to be able to be respected. I don't know. I keep saying respected, but I want to be able to be a scientist who is clear about her motivation and her goals in her career, or at least in the projects I do. And at the same time, be okay to have a desire to have a family. And I feel like there's talk about these things, and there's it seems to be sort of on paper, or it seems to be accepted. But in my head, I'm still wondering, okay, is there a place for me as this, is science open-minded enough to let in so much diversity that every person can think of themselves as a potential scientist, no matter their background, no matter their ideas, no matter the things that they come with, like the whole package. Can people feel like their authentic self can have a place in science? I feel like, yeah, I'm not so sure. I want to be sure, but I'm not convinced yet. Let's say it like
I see. So what would you say is the biggest challenge in being a scientist?
The biggest challenge of being a scientist? I don't know, because I can only say from myself, with my privilege and with my, because I was very lucky. And I think, like, I was lucky with the people that I was surrounded with as a family, but also my teachers. And I remember I was thinking about this topic, and I remember thinking for myself, okay, if I wasn't told by all my teachers that I could do this, I would never have thought I could. And I think there must be people out there who are very talented and could do great science, but they don't have that same luck, right? Mm-hmm. So I think they would have very different challenges. Mm-hmm. And personally, for me, my main challenge, I think, is at the moment, it is trying to live a full life. And I'm asking myself lots of questions about science now, but also in the future. Like, can I work from 9 to 5 and just my working hours and be a good scientist and get the kind of outputs that is desired of me for my function, right? And to be allowed to keep going. And can I be okay with all these short-term contracts? And will I ever be able to have a long-term contract? And right. As I said before, will I ever feel like, because I just told you I believe in God, I sort of mumbled it in between, but I before I told you, you didn't know, even though we worked together, my colleagues don't know. And for me, it's something I keep very private, at work at least. And I don't know, it's not like I'm ashamed of it, but I do know that I worry of not being respected. And I think I worry that it's not considered to be professional. So of course, it's not part of my working life, But to me, it is very much of my way of thinking, because both of my faith and my science, it's about asking questions, not settling for easy answers, and believing there's something to be found and like working hard to get that. And I think having this idea in my mind that it's not professional to be identified as a maybe Christian or as a believer, that it's not professional, I feel like before I feel at home in science, I need to be convinced that being professional scientist is doing a good job, and also being kind, and yeah, I feel like maybe being open-minded and be authentic and inclusive, I feel like I want that to be professional, and I'm not so sure that is considered to be professional in science now.
On a more positive note, yes. What is the best thing or the thing that you like the most about being a scientist?
I love about science that I can think about questions that I've always been wondering, and actually I'm being helped with the knowledge and the materials and the facility to actually answer, or trying to get a little bit of the answer. And I love how we can use our curiosity, and we are asked, or our job is to try and find these questions, the answers to these questions. And I feel like it's such a privilege. Like, for example, in my PhD, no, sorry, in my undergrad, I had all these questions about elephant crop consumption. And I was wondering, okay, but why do they eat these crops? And then in my PhD, I'm basically given all this money, and all I had to do was trying to come up with the questions. But I already had these questions. I always wondered, what does this have to do with the nutrients? And then I was actually allowed to figure out, with the help of my professors, the methods to actually study this. And I feel like it's so amazing.
Do you have any advice for people who might like conservation or might be passionate about certain species and they want to get into a PhD, they want to get into science or things like that?
Yes. Okay, because it's hard for me to speak to everyone, right? And because I know we all have, I was privileged to go to great school, and in the Netherlands, it's also easy to go into a good university. And I know not everybody has that. So I like the practical stuff, I'm not sure I actually can advise, because I was also very lucky to be able to go to Oxford. And just having that label, I know it opens doors to me. Even me having English master's, because mm-hmm. in Netherlands, most masters are in English. And that actually helped me, because I couldn't go into my PhD program almost, because mm-hmm. I didn't have the money to do this test. And I was mm-hmm. at the point where my old professor from my master thesis was going to offer to pay for this $300 test. And I think, because actually in the end, I didn't have to do the test because I did the English master, but I'm sure there's lots of countries where you don't have this. Mm-hmm. And then how can you, if you don't have the money, how can you pay for that test, right? At the time I was having 5 jobs. So it was also not easy. Like
5?
Yes. Because after my master's, I couldn't find a job, actually. I couldn't find a job, and then I got a PhD in Oxford. So basically, after my master's, I couldn't find a job. I was a dog walker, and I worked as a waitress and a coffee girl in the conference/hotel. And then I was, I interviewed farmers over the phone. I did that throughout my studies. And then I also tutored chemistry and English. And I was a student assistant at university because I always loved teaching and I wanted to have this link with university. And I remember, okay, maybe this is not the answer to the story, but I remember how I got to this PhD. So maybe that's a good way to answer. So one point, because I was still going to university, I don't know how I got into the library, but I was sitting there behind the computer. And at one point I just got fed up and I just typed in the words that I really wanted to have in my job, because I didn't even want to do a PhD necessarily. And I just wanted to work with elephants, apparently. So I typed in elephant conflict Africa. I feel like that, oh no, and PhD at the time. So I don't know, this is very silly. But the first hit was this program of 3 PhDs in Texas. And then there was this one tiny line in the bottom that says, oh, and there will be 1 PhD student doing and a PhD in animal ecology at Oxford University. I never really thought about this university. I didn't really realize how considered how difficult it was considered to go in. But I remember going out of that library room, going to the hallway, calling my mom, and I told her, I'm going to do this. And then she was like, you're going to do what? I was like, I'm going to do this PhD. Like, it was not even part of the advertisement. So it was a bit, I feel like it's almost irrational, but I'm a very determined person. So I just decided. And then I did lots of stalking and I figured out who was going to be the supervisor of this PhD at Oxford. So I just emailed this man and I was like, hi, I'm going to do this PhD. So how do I get in? And then he told me, okay, you have to go and get into Oxford. And then I have to go and be accepted by this NGO. So I just started doing those things and tried to apply. And at one point I got in. And I didn't have the full funding because I was EU, not UK. And then we had to try and find the funding. And there was lots of hassle. At some point, I was offered a really big grant scholarship in the Netherlands, but then I had to pay it back and it was 10,000 of euros. So I was contemplating whether to take that. And then I was offered a job at the university, right? Like science, public outreach, science writing. Mm-hmm. And it was a really cool job and I'm my favorite university. So I was really excited to take that one. So I actually rejected the offer for the PhD. And then I just got one line back and it said, we have the money. Or like, because the next day I was going to sign this new work contract. So something like, don't sign, we have the money. And it was so dramatic. And I started calling this office and I was like, okay, they say they have the money, but I need a little bit more to turn out this other great job offer, right? So, and then they closed the office for the weekend. So I just had no other option than to tell this new boss I was going to have that I actually might be able to do the PhD. And because I'm very TMI, as you might have realized. So I told him already that I was trying to get this PhD and he still offered the job. So he's very kind. And then he was also very kind saying, oh, no, this is a great opportunity. Just wait. What will happen? And let me know. We'll sign it after the weekend. And then on Monday, I had the call with them. And actually, they figured out how to get me full scholarship. And because a college, Pembroke College, was offering me a student scholarship. And then I could do this PhD. So less than a month later, I think, I was there. I remember even I was still, because after my master's, I had this advice from my supervisor from my bachelor, who I actually went to, and I told him, I want to do a PhD with you. And he said, I have no money, sorry. But he told me to get a driver's license, because I actually didn't know how to drive, because I never had the money. So that's also why I had the five jobs. And my parents were actually, at the time, always helping me with lots of money, because I couldn't afford my rent. And then I was taking all these driver's licenses and I failed my test a few times. And I remember around this time, I also failed the test. And then I had 1 week before I was going to move to the UK and I had to get my driver's license and I managed after the third attempt, I think. So actually it was a very chaotic time, but I feel like I was so lucky with all this help and also, yeah, maybe being determined that helped maybe and having, like, for me, the goal was to not necessarily do a PhD, but to do something that made me feel excited and happy. And I feel like I would have just been, I would also have been excited and happy doing this other job. Mm-hmm. And I would have found a way. I think the things I also like about science is reading, it's learning, it's writing. And I feel like maybe try not just to focus so hard on doing a PhD. Or try and focus, okay, what are the things that make me happy? And what are the things that I want to have in my job? And I'm still wondering, should I be in science? Because I'm wondering, okay, the things that I value and the things that I find important in life, can I get them in this job, right? Can I get that authenticity and inclusivity or diversity is the golden standard and not this objective, almost clinical way of living and not having a life outside of science. That should not be the gold standard in my eyes, right? So I feel like having that, and maybe I think many people will be with me that there's bad stuff that can happen in science, and there's maybe as a woman, you don't always feel respected. Like, maybe it sounds like I have to give evidence right now, but like it was common for me if I was teaching with a group of students and I was explaining something to someone that a guy would just show up and take over without any need for that. And I remember very, very clearly in my brain, this once happened. I just stood back and I was just standing in the back of the classroom again. And a friend was standing next to me and he was asking, "Are you just going to let that happen?" And I remember my answer to him. I was like, "I'm just so tired." And I don't even know. I was just tired that day. But I mean, it was so common, you know, it's just exhausting.
So you were explaining something to the class and like some
to
guy
like a
just...
specific student at the art course.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and this guy just takes over. And I remember him asking it. And my answer, I don't know. Yeah, I was tired because it is tiring and you have to keep going. And like, maybe I should have spoken up. And I sometimes did speak up and have almost conflicts because the guys were not. But right. I just also, I like that this story has this other guy also noticing, because I mm-hmm. feel like maybe with men or maybe with anyone who's sometimes seen as the norm, it's hard to imagine, like I'm also often the norm, right? But it's hard to imagine that it's actually happening and not just someone complaining or being difficult or, mm-hmm. yeah. And also, so for that, I would say maybe know who you are, because I had to be very aware of that I was a good scientist. Also, I've been told behind my back that I was at the bottom of intelligence list. I was told the first week when I first started my PhD project, I was literally told by someone, nobody wanted me there, I shouldn't be there. And the whole time I had to work with this person, I didn't feel welcome, obviously. So like, there's lots of things. There's professors who will cross boundaries. And if you don't know where these boundaries are, it's going to be very difficult afterwards, because I feel like if I would have set my boundaries more clear beforehand, if I know that one professor has no strong impact on my career and me standing up to someone is okay, I feel like I would have had a more relaxed experience maybe. I think maybe being a scientist or being in science or studying to be a science is not only about the science. It's also about you grounding yourself, knowing yourself, being confident. And also for me right now, I'm trying to think, okay, the next step in my science career is going to be me helping other people, right? And teaching other people. And am I ready for that? So what I need to do is prepare myself. And I'm reading books on like good management practices. And also I feel like I'm also reading a lot on this topic we talked about earlier. And I think like The Big Conservation Night is by John Mbara and Mordecai Ogada. I would recommend it to everyone interested in going to conservation, because there's lots of things that we need to learn before, I think. Mm-hmm. And also, of course, I'm learning at the same time. So it doesn't have to be before, but it will save you lots of effort, I think. Or lots of, it's better to learn from other people's mistakes, I think, than make them all again yourself.
And Google your dream job. That's another advice.
Yes, Google it with very, very simple words.
And have no problem with emailing people. I think that's
And also, I don't know, be a bit crazy maybe. Because, maybe be a bit, I don't know, bold is the right word. But if you just feel this passion, like you feel like something is a good thing to do or a good thing to try, just. And because I'm very shy, and like naturally, and I'm also really easily intimidated by dominant people. But just try and make it till you make it. Try and like look at the people. That's what I'm trying, at least. Look at the people you admire and see, okay, what is it about them I admire and how can I get that? So, and for me, for example, a good scientist is the people I look up to. They're not the ones with the great high impact papers or the that are in the spotlight. They are more the scientists that that are actually making a difference, not just for in their science and the topics they choose, but also in how they treat their students and the people around them. And copy a bit, maybe copy the people you admire.
Oh, that's great advice. I think that's great advice.
Yeah.
And as a last question, you mentioned a couple of times that you question yourself whether it's possible to achieve a work-life balance as a researcher. Mm. And if you can tell me more about how you deal with that, or how do you try to achieve this balance between work and personal life?
I think living very consciously helps. and being a scientist very consciously. And I don't mean that to sound like I do it perfect, but for me, I value my scientific health or like my scientific career as highly or maybe less highly than my mental health and my physical health and my spiritual health and my relational health. And I think what I said before, like seeing myself as this complex and this diverse person, because I feel like the moment I start to overwork or I work in the evenings or in the weekends, there's no time and no space for those other things. And diminishing that time, actually, where I spend my time, that's where my priority should be, right? Mm-hmm. And I think the tricky thing is that I'm not sure if my way of doing it actually will allow me to get higher up in academia. But I feel like for myself, I decided during my PhD, I don't want to be important and I don't want to be rich. I was like, I'm in the wrong career if I did have those as goals. But I feel like for me, just literally deciding that just made me feel so more relieved that, okay, I'm in this. I want to do a great job in science. I know if I want to do a great job, I have to be in a good place. Because if I'm not taking care of my mental health or anything else, I know I can't do good science. So I see that very clearly. But at the same time, yes, having decided I don't want to achieve fame or I don't want to achieve being a big name and I don't want to achieve becoming rich, I feel like it cuts off quite some opportunities maybe or like some things, but also it made me refocus and like remember what it is about for me. And I remember at my FIFA, I told my assessors this, so at the defense of my PhD, and then one of them said, okay, I think you should add that I don't want to be bored. So I feel like those are great goals in science.
So what do you mean? So by not being an important person, you mean not a famous person, right?
Like, yes.
Not...
So I want to do important stuff or things that I think are important. Like I wouldn't spend so much time and so much of my energy and also obviously out of working hours time, because I'm saying this, but I think we all overwork. Because we feel passionate, right? So I want to do things right. I think are important. And I think I'm also doubting if I should be in science, but if I feel like other people can do exactly what I'm doing, then I shouldn't be. Like, for me, the highest goal is not to be in science. For me, the highest goal is doing something that I think is important. Mm-hmm. And I feel like I make a joke, like I don't want to be important or don't want to be rich, but it's for me to refocus, okay. Right. What is science about? How much do I sacrifice if any of these other things, like my other types of health or parts of me, become are being sacrificed for this science goal, then I know what I'm going to choose. Mm-hmm. And I feel like as long as I keep finding great supervisors and great supportive bosses and professors I work with that actually tell me, literally, I value your other types of health as well. It's okay. You need to take rest and you need to do these things. Then as long as that happens, I'm happy. If there's a point where I feel like I'm not encountering these supportive people and I become overwhelmed by this sort of toxic behavior of overworking, then I'm gonna go out. And yeah.
I think the positive thing is that the number of supportive supervisors, and I think it's growing.
Yes.
And the number of people in academia that understand the importance of a healthy life in all its aspects, not
yes.
only in terms of number of publications and each
and
index.
I think, yeah, and I feel like we have a lot of credit of that should go to maybe this mentality of including more diversity. And I mm-hmm. feel like including more diversity is not just hiring more diverse people. It is also making them feel at home, right?
Right,
and I think
yeah.
we're starting to try and, or I'm just talking like I've been in science forever, but I feel like whatever I'm seeing is that people are wanting to create this home and allow people to actually feel at home while being diverse. But I feel like we all always have a very long way to go and there's lots of things to learn, but yeah, it's nice to encounter that at least.
But you know, like Susanne, now you were on a podcast, so you might not achieve your goal of not being famous.
Well, I feel like I think one of the things I wrote down some things I definitely wanted to mention, and one of the things I definitely want to mention is that I can sometimes maybe sound a bit like I feel like I know lots of things, but actually I feel like I just know what I need to learn, and I'm mm-hmm. yeah, I feel like that's also one of the worries I had about the podcast, because I'm sort of isolated in time, not isolated, but I'm taking in time and frozen in this time. And this seems to be my opinion. Well, actually, my opinion is constantly developing, and I'm learning right. so much from other people and what I'm reading. And it's almost scary. I think maybe, I don't know if it's extra scary as a scientist, but to be pinned down and be asked right. these questions and your opinion and your background.
Great. Thank you so much. This was a wonderful conversation, and I hope to catch up again yes. soon. Thank you very much for being here.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.